I think the reason I developed so well in this field is that I didn't listen so much to what Andrew Gleason said when he showed me how to prove some theorem or what McCulloch said about his particular theory, but I was always asking, how did he think of that? And sometimes I'd ask him, and he'd tell me some wrong theory, because nobody knows how they think of things. But the idea that what students should learn from their teachers is how they work, not the subject they're teaching. And I think it was just a great accident that I encountered this Warren McCulloch, who was interested in that as much as in the... He was interested in how he would think and tried to explain it. And even today, which is 40 years later, sometimes when I'm stuck writing something, for example, I could hear his voice. He's saying, oh, that's too pretentious, or that's not pretentious enough. And I think I've accumulated a cloud of these people. There are four or five people that I worked with for several years, and whenever I'm stuck, I can hear Oliver Selfridge or Dick Feynman or Andy Gleason say, oh, you're wasting your time. Why didn't you look at it this way? And it's almost as though I've made little copies of these guys.
So there's a Richard Feynman in your brain.
There's a little Richard Feynman, and there's a Theodore Sturgeon, the science fiction writer who I tracked around with, and because his science wasn't very good, but his intuitions about it were good, and he could write these wonderful things and create these images, and I just wanted to know how to do that. Never got very good at it, but I can sometimes say, what would Richard Sturgeon say, or what would Isaac Asimov say? I have about 10 of these characters that I can exploit.